It's a woman, and her name is none other than Sister Keke, Keke Oganda. She says she's a wife and a mother of four and live in Nairobi, Kenya, and in telecommunication industry. And she says she's an engineer by training, having survived the loss of her parents at a very early age and a stage 3 cancer, breast cancer survivor, and a COVID earlier this year. And she says she has a lot to thank the Lord for all that he has done in her life. And she worship at Lovington SDA Church in Nairobi, Kenya. Sister Keke, this is your time that the Lord is going to use you mightily. May the Holy Spirit bless you and carry you, my sister, as we worship together with you.
Good morning, Mam Zodwa, and all the saints of God. It is an honor to be on this platform this morning. It's just so much joy to be in the presence of the Lord. And with the few minutes I have, I am here to say that God does not let his people down. Allow me to start by sharing from the book of Philippians, chapter 4, from verse 4 to verse 7. I won't read the whole of it, but where I want us to focus on is on verse 7, which says, "And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." Today is a day of thanksgiving, and we have so much to thank God for. When I was given the opportunity to be able to share this morning on this platform, I said, what can I say to the saints of God? There is so much that we can thank God for in the various spheres that we find ourselves in. Every day we wake up, even just by the fact that we are awake, it is an opportunity to give God thanks. There are things that happen in our lives that we even doubt that God is with us. When God is telling us in Philippians chapter 4 that rejoice in the Lord always, and I will say it again, rejoice. You will find yourself in a circumstance where you're doubting that that is a circumstance in which you're supposed to be really rejoicing in God. And if I can share from my experience, when I got my cancer diagnosis, I said to God, you know, we need to talk. What am I here exactly to thank you for? How can I rejoice in a diagnosis that we know has taken so many lives? This was even before COVID happened. This was 3 years ago. And I said to God, is this a situation really to rejoice? I'm in pain. I'm going to lose parts of my body. How am I going to relate? How am I going to, you know, go out? How will I continue to be a mother? How will I be a wife? What will I do? What will I say to my friends? Will I be able to still have the same friends when I'm done with this? How can I rejoice in this circumstance? But God knows that we will ask him such questions. So God was very clear in my path, in my recovery path. Throughout the treatment, every time that I'd walk into clinic, and there are days when I'd walk into clinic and really have a confrontation with my doctor because I did not like the way I was feeling. And I felt like I was not being understood by my caregivers. But I walked into clinic and I said to my doctor one day, I said to him, I'm not ready to continue with treatment. He said, you know what? You need to remember that you have children. And he said to me, if you do not trust me, I cannot continue with the treatment. That put my mind in a different space. And I said to God, when I went back to pray that day, and I said, God, yeah, I think what the professor said to me in clinic today is the same thing you're saying to me. Trust me. Trust me, I will get you through this. But when we are in our deepest pain, at the point when the pain is consuming us, and at the point when we are not seeing the end from where we are, at the point when we are consumed by our current circumstance, whether it is in our sickness, whether it is in the confusion, in the dispensation we are living right now, which is the dispensation of job loss, we are so consumed with this current circumstance that we're failing to see that God is saying, trust me, I've got you. I will take you to the end of this. It is in our weakness, it is in our human weakness to say, how will I get to the end of this? Where is this going? How am I going to be able to get to the next phase? I don't want to let go of what my current life is. I don't want to let go of life as I know it now. because at that point, you know life in a certain way. I knew my life as taking the children to school, dressing up, going into work, coming home, and figuring out life, you know, in the compound. What am I supposed to do now? How will Sabbath look? Then what do we do on Sunday? And what will we do when the children are on holiday? But this had ground to a halt. It's like God was saying, pause. I need to do something with you. I need you to do something for me. So God was using, and I think that was my greatest lesson, is that God uses our weakest circumstances to say, let me show people that I truly am God. Allow me to minister through your weakness for my sake, for my kingdom, so that people will know me through your weakness. And I remember the first time that I got the courage to put on a shirt without feeling the embarrassment of saying, God, I have lost my body parts. I have lost things that were, I was holding on to as my identity. I said, God, let me have an identity in you. To put on that robe and say, God, allow me to walk out and let people say, it's not her hair that's defining her. It's not how she looks physically that's defining her. It's not what she does that is going to define her. It is who God is in her. That is a testimony that I wanted to be able to walk out and testify with. But to navigate from the point where I was in pain to the point of allowing God really to be the person that was speaking through me was not an easy journey. God will always present you with an opportunity to say, let me do this for you. Let me walk you through this. So God opened very many opportunities for me to be able to know him through prayer. He opened various prayer opportunities. I was not able to go to church for a long time. But God said, even if you're not able to go to church, I will bring church to you. I am here. I'm not in a building. I'm not moving. So God was walking with me right through it. And this is my encouragement for us this morning, to say that God is not blind to our tears. In the circumstance we find ourselves in, that will, you know, want us to be disabled, because pain disables us. It blocks our minds. It freezes us. We stay frozen in a moment in time to say, I can't do this. I can't move forward. I do not know what tomorrow looks like. But you have no control of tomorrow, you and I. We don't have a control of tomorrow because we're already blessed with today. So today we have it. We have God's blessings. We have an opportunity to be in his presence. We have an opportunity to testify one to another. Wherever we find ourselves seated, you will find yourself seated in the bus. You'll find yourself seated even, you know, here on a space where God is just sending us. And God is saying, speak to somebody. Somebody wants to hear what you have to say about me. God wants to testify through the lives that he has given us. Three things came out for me. Your struggle is because you have a purpose. Whatever we find ourselves struggling with, are you struggling with illness? Are we struggling even to understand why God has let our loved ones sleep? Because when we are, there is a point where you say, I need to be able to ring my mom. For those who are widows, you need to be able to ring my husband. But they are not there. They have slept. But God is saying, I know that this is painful for you. But let me use you for now until that great morning when I come back for you to be able to be a testimony to somebody else. So your struggle is because God has a purpose for you. Our prayer should be, God, show me this purpose that you have for me because you have allowed me to go through this. And your struggle is also because you're powerful. You're powerful. That's why God is handing us. He never will allow us to go through something that he will not equip us for. This is what I have come to live to understand, that my struggle is because I am powerful enough to be able to go through this, not alone, but with God. God always wants to be the person that is at the center of our lives. So he's allowing us a portion of this thing so we are able to go through to the next level that he has prepared us for. And lastly, your struggle is because you have a message. When they say that he'll turn your mess into a message, it's not a lie. There is a purpose in your struggle. The message that God is preparing for you, our only prayer should be, God, let me have this message only for the glory and honor of your kingdom. We cannot be the people that will take the glory and honor. I know, for instance, my doctors tried very hard. They did a lot of things. When the cancer moved to the uterus, they moved with it and they got it out. But it was because of God. How can you open up a human being and look at all the nerves interconnecting and these body organs and say that you're the one who knows what's going on. That's God. God is the one who is putting those body parts there. And when he has given the ability to our doctors, with a lot of respect for our caregivers, is because he's enabling them to save his children for his kingdom. So in every aspect, when God has given us our spiritual caregivers, who are our pastors and our elders, it's because he wants to use them to show his children that he has not left us. So in every circumstance that we find ourselves in, when God extends his hand of grace towards us through the people he has placed on earth and given us all different gifts, it's because God is saying, allow me, my child, to walk through this with you. So my encouragement this morning is, God is with us. He really is. He puts a song in our heart. For me, I found music just does it for me. I find myself singing in so many circumstances. I find a lot, you'll find very loud music in my car on a morning when I just want to tell God, I don't know what to say, but I need to sing to you. So my encouragement to us is, let's sing through these things. When Paul was writing in Philippians, which is the last verse I'll share, in Philippians chapter 1, verse 12, which says, now I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened to me has been really to advance the gospel. That is what our testimony should be. That let's allow God to say, I'm not leaving you. As Pastor Papu has shared on this platform before, that the devil is already a defeated foe and he knows it. What we know is that we serve a living God who will never leave us. So my encouragement to us is that let's testify of God's goodness to us. We're alive today. It's a huge testimony in itself. We are able to speak. Our senses are working. God is alive. God is doing things for his kingdom through us. Let us allow ourselves to be vessels for his kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. Shall we pray? I thank you, my Father, for this opportunity that you have given me to be able to share to your brethren across the world on this platform. I thank you for the coordinators on this platform, dear God, for them affording us an opportunity every day before our feet hit the ground to be able to tabernacle with you. I pray, dear Lord, that today we'll be able to testify of your goodness in our lives, to be able to say that we serve a God who will never leave us, a God who neither sleeps nor slumbers, a God who sees our tears, the most silent tears, the tears that sometimes do not leave our eyes because they're so deep. I pray, my Father in heaven, that as we speak of your goodness in our lives this morning, we will be able to encourage each other and to be able to walk in your goodness. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.